first, and thank you for the introduction, and thank you for having me. I'm sure my mom is actually even more happy that you invited me to come. I don't get back to campus very often. I'm actually based in the Netherlands with Michelle, so this worked out really well on a trip that I've got to Houston. So what I thought I would do today is, you've heard from a variety of different companies and speakers, so for lots more to come, of course, this afternoon. And so I thought I would try to share a little bit about the view from a supermajor, from a large company like Shell. How do we think about the energy transition? How do we make our decisions? What does our strategic planning look like? And then in particular, I work for our new energies business. So what is our new energies business actually up to as a result of all of that? So first and foremost, I have to start with this really exciting slide. So fascinating word from our legal folks, and this is supermajor lesson number one. You don't go anywhere without this slide. So what I really wanted to start with was some context. So I think most of us would agree that transitions are a constant. We know that there is going to be change. It's not a question of if there's going to be change, it is a question of what will that change actually be? What will it look like? And so, of course, what you see in this picture is trying to show the monumental change, the really disruptive change that we had from horse-drawn carriages to the modern trolley car. So that's fantastic. How many of you actually noticed the other thing that's going on in this picture? The car on the bottom right, of course, which was even more disruptive to the transportation sector than the main point of the picture. And so the reason I start with that is because it's a really good illustration of how does Shell go about predicting what that future will look like. We know that there's going to be some pretty radical uncertainties happening down the road. And so how do we make strategic decisions in the face of that uncertainty? So this is the audience participation portion of the talk. How many of you have heard of scenario planning? Because that's the short answer here. Of Shell scenario planning, maybe even willing to confess in public that you've read one of those scenarios. So the latest one is called Sky. We've got a team of experts. They work in-house, but with their counterparts externally to essentially paint a picture of what will the future look like, what will the future energy system potentially look like, factoring in the issue of climate change. And so the Sky scenario is the latest one that we have published, and it's actually a little bit different because it's a normative scenario. So it essentially works backwards from being a goal-driven outcome, which in this case is Paris, meeting the ambitions of the Paris Agreement. So if we want to get to that two-degree world, what do we have to do? How would we get there? So it's not a policy prescription. It's not a business plan. It is not even a forecast. We don't have that crystal ball, because you read that in the first slide, right? No crystal balls here. But it's really important because, and I'm not going to go into all of the gory details, it's online. I have a couple of hard copies if anybody is really dying for some bedtime reading. But just two things that I want to mention about Sky, because it really helped us in the formation of our new energies business. So the first one is around electrification, and you actually heard this already this morning. So really radical electrification expected to happen in the future. And so this is a business opportunity for Shell. So moving from a place today where we're maybe 18% of world electrification, or the electrification rate, to getting to say over 50% in a couple of decades. So by say 2060. So that's again a huge opportunity for Shell. The second chart that I want to show you is around the future mix in the global energy system. So again, not surprising, this is probably nothing new to any of you in this room, but the real opportunity for renewables to play a role. So if we think about where we're at today, where will fossil primary energy peak, probably around the 2030s, and then looking, say, 2040s and beyond, you've really got electrification as that primary energy carrier. And so huge opportunities for renewables if we look to the long term. So what did Shell do as a result of this? Well, I mentioned the creation of our new energies business. So that was in 2016. And we have two areas, which I'll tell you about. But the second one is power, essentially electricity. And the reason this is so important, and so I'm going to pause just for a minute to kind of talk about it, is that we are a company, a traditional oil and gas company, that is essentially built around three pillars. So oil, gas, and chemicals. And we're now talking about power becoming a significant new business alongside those three other pillars. So that's going to take time. It's going to be a journey, but it's a pretty fundamental change for a company like Shell. So what are we actually doing in this business? I mentioned new fuels and power as the two primary components. So I'll give you just a whirlwind tour in terms of what we're up to. So new fuels essentially has three components: biofuels, hydrogen, and electric mobility. So the biofuel space, in terms of future looking, is really about how do we produce biofuels, advanced biofuels, from sustainable raw materials. So that could be waste, that could be cellulosic biomass from non-plant foods, but really the advanced biofuel space. The second one is hydrogen. So this is one we haven't talked about yet today, but is a really interesting option in the transportation mix. So it's safe, it's clean, it's an affordable option. And Shell is actually rolling out hydrogen stations in a number of different places throughout the world already. The one that I'm probably most proud of is in Germany. We're actually part of a consortium rolling out hundreds of hydrogen stations in Germany. And so part of the reason I'm really proud of this example is that it's solving a chicken and egg dilemma. So if you're building hydrogen cars, why would you want to do that if there are no fueling stations? If you're building fueling stations, why would you do that if there are no hydrogen cars? So obviously, if you can go about that together, working together, you can be much more successful, and that's exactly what the H2 Mobility Network in Germany is all about. If you think about it in the U.S., you can probably imagine California is a popular place for this kind of activity, and the state has announced that it will work in partnership with, again, a number of players to roll out additional hydrogen stations in California. And that's not just for light duty for cars, but also for heavy duty vehicles, so looking at freight as well, trucks in the ports in California. And then the third one is electric mobility. So again, you've heard a lot about this one already today, both smart charging and fast charging. So Shell is playing in both of those different areas. So putting the fast charging into our, we call them forecourts in Europe, but in our retail stations essentially, but also looking at the smart charging. So again, how can you charge your car off when it's not peak demand? And so instead of everybody coming home at 6 o'clock and plugging their cars in and probably crashing the grid, how can we do that smart management to save you money as a customer and hopefully to stave off maybe infrastructure upgrades that would be required for this growth? So that's a little bit about what we're doing in the new fuel space. And then back to the power space. So this is where the solar and the wind that everybody kind of understands, the low carbon generation plays. But I will also pause to say that gas is an important part of this solution. So as we think about how do you manage the intermittency that may come with renewables, and by the way, I'm also presuming that storage, you heard about storage too, is sort of table stakes for all of this, and that will evolve over time. But when you need a backup to those renewables, we believe that natural gas is a really good solution. And of course, Shell is strong in that space as well. So in terms of what we're doing in wind and in solar, we are not necessarily new to this space. People don't necessarily know everything that we have been doing, but we've got quite a history with wind in the US here. Our first onshore wind farm started back in 2001. So we have a handful of wind farms spread throughout the US. Those are onshore. We also have offshore operations. So in the Netherlands, we have an operational wind farm, and we've got another one that we just took final investment decision on that's part of a consortium. So looking both at onshore and offshore, although I will say we think probably more of the opportunities in the offshore space. So that's kind of what we're doing. And then what I thought I would do is step back and say, well, what are the typical questions that we get about this business, and try to answer those for you. So question number one, how much money are you guys spending? Is this real? Are you committed to it? So you see the answer, of course, on the slide, $1 to $2 billion per year on average. And again, I have to pause here and say that is not a target. And to be really, really clear, that we're not spending for the sake of spending. So it should be no surprise we're standing in a business school that you guys understand that we have some real expectations from our shareholders and some real requirements to deliver the returns to which they have become accustomed. And so particularly for Shell, we've gone through a number of years of really trying to instill additional capital discipline into our business. And I think our Q3 results, which were just announced, are evidence of that. But we have to be really conscious of our shareholder expectations and not to overplay this business too fast, too soon, because it is still a bit of a hypothesis testing for us, and we are still essentially in learning mode in some of these areas and trying to understand a very shifting landscape. So if you stay tuned, I think that number hopefully will grow over time, but right now what we have indicated is through 2020, we expect about $1 to $2 billion to be what our capital investment will be in this space. The second question that we often get is around, well, why is Shell going to be successful? What do you bring to the table that makes you unique? And the short answer to that is integration. So if we look at the power value chain, Shell plays across a number of different places in this power value chain. So people often start on the right-hand side, so that's the supply and the generation side, so building the solar farms, building the wind farms that we've talked about. But I actually want to talk a little bit about the trading business that Shell has, and that's the middle block, the optimization block that you see there. Because at least here in North America, Shell Energy North America, which is our local organization, has been in this space for over 20 years, right? So power trader, wholesale supplier, and actually 1/3 of their portfolio is renewables already. So really solid foundation that Shell can start from. Our Shell Energy Europe organization and Asia as well are following suit, so you're gonna see a lot of growth, but we're not starting from scratch by any stretch in that particular space. And then the third, but probably the most important part is customers. So really getting that access to the customer directly is something that Shell is increasingly going after. And we are already there. It's both in the commercial and industrial C&I customers, but also residential customers. So I'll talk a little bit about that. And then if you step back, again, why does Shell think that it brings something unique into this space? Well, we have the benefit of a global presence, right? We operate in a lot of different countries. So if you think about the power markets that we're probably interested in, so deregulated markets in particular, we probably have a presence in those countries. We've probably got some traditional operations, some knowledge and understanding of those markets, and we bring a brand that's generally well recognized. So the next question then is, well, what are you actually doing about this? How have you succeeded thus far? Show us the proof, show us some evidence. As you can imagine, Shell wants to play at scale, right? That's for us, it's about being at scale, being pretty large. And so there's a number of ways to succeed, and that could be inorganically, it could be organically, and we're pursuing growth in both of those spaces. So we have about 300 people on our new energies team now within that unit. So that's directly not the functional support, not the legal, not the HR. But we also recognize that that said, the in-house expertise can really be supplemented by inorganic growth, so acquisitions of other companies. That's really gonna be how we speed up that learning and how we speed up that delivery. So this is a mix of full acquisitions, minority investments that Shell has made. Hopefully it just shows you the trend upward in terms of the activity levels over time and the mix of the different areas that we've been active in. So I've mentioned a couple already, a few more to point out. So New Motion is an electric vehicle charging network in Europe, one of the largest that we recently acquired. MP2 Energy here in the US is predominantly a C&I energy supplier that we have bought into. And then I mentioned residential is another component of the customer market. And so First Utilities, a company that we bought in the UK, one of the leading independent suppliers there, has well over 800,000 homes that they provide energy to. So again, you're seeing how Shell has hopefully walked the talk that I've just mentioned. For those of you who have really good eyesight and are interested in the VC space, you'll notice that there's a number of deals on here from what we call our Shell Ventures arm. So this is our corporate VC arm. Lots of other companies have this as well. So Shell is certainly not the only super major. And by the way, I mean, I'm sure you guys are familiar with some of the other acquisitions that have gone on in the industry, but BP has bought LightSource, has bought ChargeMaster. So Shell is not by any stretch the only one making some of these moves in this space. But we do have a venture capital arm that looks at those startups, those early stage companies, and tries to help them get to a commercial state, because we think that either their technologies or the business models that they're looking at are really going to be of strategic importance to our whole industry. And the last thing that I would say about Shell Ventures is it's actually really interesting, because this is, of course, the Silicon Valley, the very entrepreneurial kind of approach to business, which is not what typical oil and gas companies are known for. But it is something that New Energies is really, really trying to embrace. So this concept of failing fast. Now, obviously, failing fast, pivoting, learning from your experiences is way better than failing slowly and miserably and expensively. And I can certainly say that that mentality is alive and well in New Energies. And so we are trying to essentially evolve, not just as a company in terms of the portfolio, but a company in terms of our behaviors. So Shell Ventures invests, as I said, in some technologies that used to actually be called Shell Technology Ventures. So let's say a kite power system. But it's also increasingly looking at those business models. So when you look at the renewable space, when you look at the Internet of Things, the digital domain, connected customer, that's where predominantly investments today are going into. So it might be battery technology, but it might be battery swapping concepts overall. So that is my essentially last slide. And what I just wanted to recap with was we know transitions are going to happen. We know that's a constant. We know they're going to happen in unexpected ways. And so we are acting today because it's going to take time. We don't know all of the answers. We don't have all of the solutions yet. But I can say hand on heart that absolutely I think the new energies business has been the most exciting transition in Shell that I've been part of and the most exciting business. And so I hope that you understand a little bit more about that. Thank you.
We'll have time for one or two questions. Anyone in the audience, a question?
You showed some slides that have a little bit of a presence in India. What would you say about the mix of your investments in that part of the world compared to Western Europe and North America?
Yeah, so the way we approach our business is not necessarily by geography, but by the lines of business. So where are the opportunities best for solar, for wind, so on and so forth. And the reason the India one is up there is I didn't talk about it, but energy access. So how do we serve the underserved or unserved populations of the world? And so that could be in India, it could be in Africa, it could be in Asia. And so we've made a number of investments in companies that help with that energy access program. Yep.
One more question in the top row.
Thank you for your presentation. A lot of people think about Shell, well, I do, when I'm just going to get gas. So I'm interested to see why or how Shell is trying to change that viewpoint in terms of just being a liquid fuel, but really supporting all energy.
Yeah, so absolutely. I mean, if you look at those charts, it's going to be a combination of molecules and electrons. So just like with the sky scenario, it's an and scenario. You're going to need a lot of different factors to come together. I think for Shell, we're still going to have a lot of different parts of our portfolio to meet customer needs. So some customers may want EVs, some are going to want hydrogen, some are going to want biofuels. So there are going to be hard to electrify segments out there that simply can't function on electrons. And so the molecules are going to continue to be important. And so that's part of why I said the gas part isn't going away for us as much as some of us would like the energy transition to happen overnight. It is going to take time. And so there's going to be a mix.